Good morning, good afternoon. I have no clue where you're watching actually. So hello, welcome anyway. Wait one more minute, then it's 3 o'clock, where I am at least, and then we get started. Okay, welcome everybody, whether you're watching now live with me or you're gonna watch this back later on. Would be interesting to see where you're actually coming from. I gave this this class, this talk, some time ago, last spring actually, when the schools in the Netherlands, I'm from the Netherlands, went into lockdown for the first time, the school closed, and I decided to give a some talks about the Arctic and the Antarctic. And then I got a lot of questions whether I could do this in English as well. So, well, here I am. I think the schools are closed again in most places. Hopefully they open again soon. In the Netherlands, they just did, at least the primary schools. I hope that where you are, the schools will be open soon as well. And yeah, I hope that that life gets back to normal again, so we can do lots of other things as well. But anyway, yeah, why penguins never eat polar bears? This is me. I know you can see me in the top corner as well. Hello. Sometimes I watch at a different screen, by the way, so that's not that I'm that's why I'm looking in a different direction so every now and then. But yeah, this is me, fully dressed for tropical regions. Oh no, hang on, for polar regions. Of course, it's cold there, so yeah, as it's cold, I will sometimes have to put on a bit more clothes. But yeah, more on that later. And this is my home, and this is the place where I spent most of my year. Well, not this year, of course, but most of the years, this is the place where I spent sometimes even more time than at my own home. This is the Ortelius. Here a picture of me. Sorry. Here a picture of me where you can see me a bit better. Well, my name is Arjen Drost. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a biologist. I studied biology here at the University in Groningen. And then for my study, I went to Spitsbergen for the first time in the Arctic. And yeah, I fell in love with the Arctic and I really wanted to go back. And for me, the best way of going back was to work as an expedition guide. So I switched to expedition guiding after a short science career. I switched to expedition guiding on the ships that you just saw. So basically what I do is I give people, make sure that people have a nice holiday in the Arctic or the Antarctic in the polar regions. And I bring them back home safely. That's also, of course, a very, and especially in these conditions, it's quite a difficult, or well, not difficult, but an important thing, of course. Apart from that, I'm a nature photographer and a nature filmmaker. All the movies and pictures that you see, well, of course, except for the ones that feature me, but I made myself. And I've been a teacher and a biology teacher in a secondary school for some years until I decided that guiding was a lot more fun than teaching, even though you still teach as a guide, of course. But yeah, my classroom now is a lot better as the classroom I had at my school. Now, if you look at my at the picture, one thing that sticks out, of course, except for me not having a lot of hair, is the big rifle I have in my hand. Now, honestly, I'd much rather not have that thing in my hand, and I would much rather not have. I'm not really a gun in favor of guns. I don't like them too much, and they're heavy and they're annoying. So I'd much rather not have them. But especially when we're going around in the Arctic, we find signs like this. Not too many, because there are only three signs like this on the whole archipelago. But it means watch out crossing polar bears. And yeah, the polar bears, they can be everywhere. And that's what it says on the sign underneath. This is valid for the whole of Spitsbergen, or the whole of Svalbard, as the Norwegians call it. And of course, all the passengers that come with us, they want to see a polar bear. I mean, I want to see a polar bear. Polar bears are great. Polar bears are awesome. However, polar bears also eat humans if they get the chance. So we much rather, well, we do like to see polar bears, but on a safe distance. Or sometimes we like to see polar bears up close, and like this one. This one was really close. But now I'm on the ship, and the bear's on the ice, and the bear can't get on the ship, and we won't go into the ice. So then we are safe, and the polar bear is safe. And that's by far the best option to see polar bears, I would say. And the polar bear decides if it comes closer or not. If it's close, then hooray. If it doesn't, then well, that's fine as well. I mean, it's the bear who decides. Now, if we're on shore, then it's a different story. On shore, I don't like to see polar bears, because like I said, polar bears, they might eat humans, and I don't like to get eaten, and I'd like to bring all the passengers back as well. So yeah, that's a bit a thing. So if we see a polar bear, usually it's a long, long distance away that we find the polar bear, and we will just withdraw. We go back into our Zodiac, into our small rubber boats, go back to the ship, and maybe have a look from the ship at the polar bear or something like that, at least from a safe distance or a safe position. So that's what happens in 99% of the times when we see a bear. Then we would just withdraw and there is nothing going on. In my 20 years that I've been to Spitsbergen, I've only once had to go to the next step, and that was when the bear was getting really close. It just appeared from behind a rock, from behind a hill. There was a bit of fog over there, and suddenly there was this polar bear coming our way, and not aggressive, not running, or not going towards us and doing things, but yeah, was interested and so on, was looking at us and sniffing and seeing what's that. I don't know, that maybe I can eat it. So I decided, I had my flare pistol with me, so I decided to shoot a flare in the sky that just makes a big loud bang, and then the bear just like, whoa, what the hell is that? I just go on and run away, and that was it. And the bear spent the next 15 minutes looking at us like, what the heck was that? There was suddenly this big loud noise, and I don't like it. So I just, well, and then we could withdraw to the ship and we were safe. And that's actually the only time that I had an sort of scary encounter with a polar bear. Now, why do we have the rifle? Well, we have the rifle that in case the bear is not afraid of the sound, and if we start waving and shouting and stuff, then the bear would still come towards us, and the bear is really getting close. Well, yeah, then finally I might have to shoot the bear. I'd much rather not, honestly, but yeah. Being eaten by a bear or shooting the bear, well, then I have to go. But I would hate it if I had to do that. But fortunately, I never had to do it, and I hope I never will. On a cheerier note, this is me as well, a little bit smaller. I'm the one standing, driving the Zodiac. This is what we call a Zodiac, the rubber inflatable boat that takes us everywhere, basically. So if we want to go ashore, we use the rubber boat. If we want to go cruising around, we take the rubber boat. In this case, we were just looking at icebergs and maybe some wildlife around on the icebergs, giving the passengers a good opportunity to take some pictures and stuff and just enjoy. And yeah, like I said, this is the ship that I work on most. This is the Ortelius. Ortelius, really nice ship. I really love it. It's strong in the ice. It's not an icebreaker. We have to push the ice away. Not the big icebergs that you see here, of course, but the ice flows we can push away. And yeah, it's a bit our hotel. We just bring our own hotel and then we go and do some things. We go ashore and do things there. And then when we're done, we go back to the ship, have a nice meal, go to sleep. The ship moves on to the next location and so on and so on. Which is a really nice way of traveling, I would say. To show you a little bit about how that works while traveling. I have a small movie that I made during one of the trips in the Arctic. So yeah, just enjoy. I will explain a little bit on what we're seeing. Just enjoy, see what you can see, and yeah, we'll continue later. And you see, sometimes it can be really nice. Nice, flat, calm seas, beautiful sunlight, a bit of ice and birds. I call this movie The Search because that's what we do a lot, actually. Yeah, this is my colleague Ali, and Ali is searching for things on the ice. She's still searching. Ah, I found something already on the ice. Did you see it as well? Ah, there it is. Now it's a bit more obvious, isn't it? This is a bearded seal. Bearded seals, they like to dive in the ocean, catch fish, catch shrimps or other water animals. And then when their belly is full, they come and lay on the ice, hauling out, sleeping a little bit maybe, resting. And then when they get hungry, they jump in again. This is the bridge where we steer the ship. And of course, you see two colleagues of mine, Sasha and Misha, they're searching again because, well, we found the seal. Now we want to find something else. Oh, look, we spotted the polar bear, he says. So we found a bear. Oh, there it is. Not that close yet, but maybe we can get a bit closer. Oh, here. Looks a bit like a sleepy bear, doesn't it? Maybe it's just been eating, and now it wakes up. Oh, a nice yawn, stretch your legs a little. And they have a very good sense of smell. So yeah, if you might smell someday, they might smell us maybe. Walk around a little. They're often walking around just searching for food. They're always hungry, always looking for food. And sometimes they're really curious and they come towards us. They come and check us out to see what we are. They don't know us, so maybe, I have no clue, come and have a look. Which of course for our passengers is awesome. They can just have a look, jump from one float, whoops. They can swim, but they much rather jump. The water is cold, well, obviously. Look at all the ice. And then he moves on again to the next place and maybe find something else. Yeah, time for a little map just to show where we are in the world. This map is, for me, it's a very, very normal map. But if you look from on top of the world, if you have a globe, then there's always two sticks holding the globe together. Then the top stick comes out here at this cross. This is the geographical North Pole. And the yellow line is the Arctic Circle. That's what one of the definitions of the Arctic. So inside the yellow line is the Arctic, one could say. And then, yeah, this is Greenland. This is Canada, Alaska, Siberia. Siberia is very long. And then here's Scandinavia. I am somewhere, well, this is the UK, so I'm somewhere down there. It's not on the map, really. These are the two places where I've been myself. This is, this one here is Spitsbergen. That's the place where I spend most of my time, actually. And this is Greenland. Well, this whole island is Greenland, but I've been only to this little bit. So most of the pictures, or all the pictures actually that you see, come from these two regions. But what you notice, especially when you look, there is this big blue thing in the middle. Now, blue is water. Well, it's frozen water, so it could actually also be white because it's water. And that means there is this big ocean. Well, it says Arctic Ocean. Big ocean in the middle, and then it's surrounded by land. So the Arctic looks like this. Yeah, this is the frozen ocean, the frozen Arctic Ocean. And that's most of it, actually. And so underneath, and if you look here, for instance, or here, there is actually water. So, and that water can be, I don't know, a couple of thousand meters deep. There is lots of water there. And then at the edges of the ocean, this is still the frozen ocean, you have land. And that's the place where we have where we find, well, where we are, of course, because we're on the ship, so we need water, not too much ice. But yeah, we like to go on shore, so we need land as well. But it's also where most of the wildlife is, because lots of wildlife, they like to feed in the ocean because there's lots of food in the ocean. But they need the land to breed or to sleep or to do whatever. So yeah, there is lots of land as well. But of course, it is cold there. There's lots of ice. In this case, there's also snow. So yeah, a lot of time in the year is just completely white on land there. However, in summer, it gets above freezing. So the snow will melt. The glaciers, hopefully not. Climate change, they might get smaller, but most of the glaciers, they stay at least partly there. And then, yeah, suddenly you have this white barren landscape with very, very little vegetation, a little bit, not too much here as well. But lots of it is just barren ground and nothing is growing there. So that's the Arctic. Now, the other side of the globe, so where the southernmost tip comes out. Again, here we have that cross where the globe is attached, if it would be a globe, of course. And then you see, suddenly, well, this is just to see where we are. This is South America, the Falklands. Somewhere up here is South Africa. We can't see that, but that's somewhere up here. And here is Australia, New Zealand, Tasmania. But you see that here, there is a big white thing in the middle, and then the blue is around. So the Southern Ocean, says here, is around the continent. Antarctica is actually land, covered by maybe 2, 3, 4 kilometers of ice. But there is land underneath. If you would drill a hole, you would get to land. So where the Arctic is a frozen ocean surrounded by land, the Antarctic is a frozen continent surrounded by ocean. Where have I been? Well, to these places, most of it I've been here, to the Antarctic Peninsula. It's closest to South America, so it's quite easy to sail, but it also has a lot of wildlife. I've been here to South Georgia, although I don't think I show any pictures during this talk of that area. And I've been here in the Ross Sea, well, and then of course in between here as well, because otherwise you can't get there, but I've been here in the Ross Sea, so you see some pictures of that as well. So how does Antarctica look like? Well, there is much more ice. There is much more ice than in the Arctic. Here you see on the edges, there is still a little bit of land, a little bit of rocks that are snow-free. It's too steep. Glaciers can't be there, but there is lots of ice. And here you see in the middle, like I said, this is not in the middle. This is still along the edge. But in the middle, there would be 2, 3, 4 kilometers of ice. And then, yeah, on the edges, you might have a little bit of land, especially on the peninsula where we most are. There will be a little bit of land. And here you look, there are even a few houses. This is a small scientific station from Argentina, but that's only inhabited in summer. So, that's not too much going on, actually. Speaking about temperatures, what temperature do we have? Well, having a temperature, having a thermometer on the North Pole is a bit difficult because that's ice and that's floating around, so that doesn't really work. So I had to pick one from one of the northernmost tips of land, the northern coast of Greenland. And then you see the temperatures are in Celsius, by the way, not in Fahrenheit, although minus 40 is minus 40 in Celsius and Fahrenheit, so that doesn't really matter. But in wintertime, December, January, February, it's around minus 40. And then in summertime, that's the moment when I get to the Arctic, it is around freezing. And usually I'm not here, but a little bit further south. So then it might actually be 5 degrees above freezing. So it's not that cold. I mean, it's still chilly for a summer day, and especially in winter, minus 40. But yeah, this is still doable. Now, if you would plot the Antarctic in it, you get to a different story. I took Vostok. I cheated a little bit. This is a station a little bit higher up on the hill. Higher up on the mountain, you're always a bit colder. So it is a very cold station. The first thing you'll notice is, of course, that the seasons are reversed. When it's summer in the northern hemisphere, it's winter in the southern hemisphere, and the other way around. So when it's warm here, it will be cold in Antarctica. And when it's cold here, it will be warm in Antarctica, something like that. So that should be reverse. Whoa, now that is cold. In summertime, it's just as cold as winter in the Arctic. In summertime, it is minus 40. Again, that doesn't matter if that's Celsius or Fahrenheit. And in wintertime, it's minus 70. Now, I do like cold weather and cold temperatures and put on some extra clothing and still go outside. But minus 70, geez, I have no clue. I think I would just stay inside with a nice heater or something. That's for me even too cold. I can't even fathom how cold that would be. So yeah, this is summarizing. This is Antarctica. You have frozen land surrounded by an ocean, which of course is also partly frozen. Of course, I mean, it's cold, so the land will have the sea will freeze there as well. And then the Arctic is a frozen ocean. I didn't want to go back. A frozen ocean surrounded by land. Good. We're roughly halfway. A little quiz, just to see how much you already know, and otherwise you can just watch the rest of the talk, and then I'll give the answers during the talk, and at the end of the talk, I will give the real answers. First, an example: which pole is colder? Will the Arctic be colder or the Antarctic be colder? Well, I just explained. In Antarctica, it's a lot colder than the Arctic, so that is clear. Then the next question: where do we find more people? And then I'm not talking about this tourist that's sitting here taking a picture of a penguin, but where do people live? Where do we find more people living? Is that again in the Arctic or the Antarctic? Where do we find more plant life? Where is this picture taken? Would it be in the Arctic or would that be in Antarctica? Now the big question of the title of the talk, well, the title of the talk, of course, is why do penguins never eat polar bears? Well, penguins don't eat meat. They're fish eaters or krill eaters, so they don't eat meat. So that's an obvious one. But why do polar bears never eat penguins? Because polar bears are predators. They would like to eat penguins. I mean, you would assume. Well, maybe penguins are too fast for polar bears. Then polar bears can't get them. Maybe penguins don't taste good. Polar bears tried, but they just taste very bad, so they don't catch them anymore. Maybe penguins and polar bears never meet. Yeah, then you can't catch them, of course. Or maybe penguins smell very bad, so polar bears, they keep a distance, stay at a distance. Which one would be true? And then the last question, do we only find penguins on Antarctica? Or do we also find them somewhere else? So, yes, we find them only on Antarctica, or no, we find them somewhere else as well. Good. Now, I will go on with the talk, and then you'll get the answers if you pay attention. People in polar regions. Hey, I think this was already a question. This is the Arctic. This is Spitsbergen, and this is where I land. There's an airport here. And then this is the capital of Spitsbergen, as we call it, Longyearbyen, named after John Munro Longyear, an American guy. And yeah, there are about 2,000, 2,500 people living there. And they actually live there. They stay there year round. And it used to be a mining town. And you see the sculpture of the mining here, the statue of the miner here. But there is a shopping center, there is a hospital, there is a university, there are hotels, there's a post office. There are lots of things that you would actually find in a big city usually, but then this one is very small city, but we would still call it a city actually. And yeah, you find lots of snow scooters here as well. In summertime, of course, snow scooters, like you can see here, are not very useful, but yeah, winter is a lot longer than summer, so in general I would say that snow scooters are a lot more useful on Spitsbergen than cars are. There are very few roads, and with snow scooters you can stay a lot longer out. This is in Greenland. There is actually the population of Spitsbergen, and it's all moved there from Norway or from other places in the world. There are rarely people born on Spitsbergen. But there are actually native people in the Arctic. This is in Greenland, and the east coast, Itakotormiit. But also in Canada, Alaska, in Siberia, there are actually people living there. They live there year round. They work there, have families there, they have schools there, they go to school there. Imagine going to a school in a place like this. Might be cool for a while, but I'm not sure if it's cool for too long, actually. So yeah, there are definitely people living there, and quite a few as well. Now, if we go to Antarctica, that's a different story. There are no people living permanently on Antarctica, actually. There are a few people, I mean, there are houses here. This is, but they're all in scientific stations. And we saw an earlier picture as well with from the helicopter with some houses. That was also a station. That was a very small station. This is the biggest station, about 2,000 people living here in summer, in winter 200. But yeah, they're only here to work. And then when their contract is finished, when they're done with their work, they fly home again, usually to the United States, because this is an American scientific base. But there are many other stations as well. But yeah, there is no real native people living here. It's not really people who belong to Antarctica that are here. So definitely more people in the Arctic than in Antarctica. Going on with nature. Look at that polar bear. It's cool, isn't it? But yeah, we first start with plants, because that's where the food chain starts as well. Well, most of the food chain actually starts in the water. But yeah, that's a bit difficult to get to, so we start on land. But yeah, there are actually plants on Antarctica. These are actually trees. These red things here, it's autumn, you see, it's a bit covered in frost. It's a birch tree, it's a dwarf birch. So they're not as tall as the birch trees that you might have at home, but they're still trees. Eh? You see the branches here, and here you see some branches. And otherwise we have grass. Yeah, there is lots of grass every now and then. It's all very small, of course. It's very cold, so the plants don't grow as tall as they do at home. But if you go down on your knees and you look closely, you actually find really nice flowers. Yeah, this beautiful saxifrage, it's really nice. And of course, if you have flowers, you have also animals who eat from the flowers. In this case, a ptarmigan, a Spitsbergen ptarmigan. Look at all the feathers at the legs. That doesn't like to get cold feet, I think. But yeah, this bird stays here the whole year. So yeah, it also is here when it's minus 20, then you do need proper insulation, I suppose. Same goes for the reindeer or caribou, if you're from the United States or Canada. The Spitsbergen reindeer, they live here the year round. They don't migrate. They can't really migrate anywhere too. And they don't live in big herds. In Canada, Alaska, you have big herds of reindeer, of caribou. In this case, it's much smaller and they stay on the same place. But yeah, in winter, look, this is all they can eat. There's hardly anything to eat for them. So they have a very hard time in winter. Arctic fox, of course, if you have animals living or birds living on land, you also have predators. In this case, an Arctic fox already in his winter coat. There is no snow yet, but he already put his winter coat on. Is looking to get some eggs or chicks or birds or whatever he can find. But yeah, most of the Arctic is quite barren. There is not that much vegetation. Most of it is dry and so on. And then if you look closely, you find one plant, in this case a poppy. But yeah, there is lots of stone and pebbles and dry and barren and not much, really. If you go to Antarctica, yeah, that's a different story. There is far less plants on Antarctica. These are the only two native species of plant on Antarctica. Here you have a small species of grass, and here you have this fatty plant. I have no clue what it's actually called in English. So yeah, that's the only two native species of plant on Antarctica. You have some mosses. Oh, you have some mosses, of course. As you can see here, this is a bone giving some extra nutrients. Here is some moss, but yeah, the two higher plants are these two. So that's it. So and most of Antarctica, well, most of Antarctica is covered by snow and ice permanently. So there's definitely no plant life. But if you have anything barren where there is no snow or ice, then it looks like this, and it's empty and dead, and you don't see anything. So there is not a lot of plant life at all. What we do have, of course, is bird life. We have penguins. Look at these penguins. Now, first of all, penguins are not a typical Antarctic species. There are 18 species of penguins. more or less, in the world. And only a few of them live on Antarctica. There are actually penguins in South America or in South Africa, New Zealand. There are even penguins on the Galapagos, on the equator. So it's definitely not, it's a southern hemisphere species. There are no penguins on the northern hemisphere, but it's definitely not the case that there are only penguins on Antarctica. But yeah, Gentoo penguins, they're really cool. And yeah, to show how cool they are, a quick movie again. Here we're still on the ship, sailing towards towards our landing site, towards our colony. Yeah, it looks really weird. I mean, these penguins, they can't fly, of course. And look at them, they don't walk that good either. But they do want to breed on top of the mountain. Here, look at that. They're all high up on the hill. Why would they do so? Well, they don't breed on snow. That's a gentoo penguin. In Dutch, we call them donkey penguins. And if you listen to them, you hear why. But yeah, penguins don't breed on snow, because if you lay your egg on the snow, then the egg freezes and the chick dies that's inside. So that doesn't work. So they need barren ground. They need rocks to breed on. That's still cold, but at least it's a little bit warmer. And where do we find the first snow-free ground? Higher up on the hills. So that's why they climb all the way up to the hills and start breeding there. Yeah, that's where they are, on the rocks. And then they make a nest. But they don't make a nest with twigs and trees and leaves and stuff. There are no. So what do? They collect rocks, they collect pebbles, and they make their nest from rocks. Oh, the pinkish color, by the way, that you see here, that's all penguin poo. Now, how do they collect rocks? Well, they might get them from the ocean, they might get them from under the snow, or, well, like you see here. Oh, that one got one. How do you get it? Well, he just stole it from this one. And you see, this one is very aggressive, trying to defend its nest, trying to chase away the others. Oh, doesn't really work. He's not doing a too good job, because this one has a small rock as well, and now brings it to his wife. Oh, look here, I have this nice pebble for you. But yeah, you see, it's a lot of orange, pinkish color, and that's all penguin poo, and that does smell quite bad, actually. And if you spend a lot of time there, then you smell bad as well. So yeah, showers are very... We have showers on the ship, and that's very good. This species of penguin actually does know how to breed on snow, and actually on the ice, because they stay the year round on in the ocean, actually. But they wait for the ocean to freeze, and then they lay their eggs. These are emperor penguins. And emperor penguins, they lay their egg on their feet, only one egg, and then they stay there the whole winter. They breed actually in winter when it was minus 40 or something. They're crazy. And then they wait until the egg hatches, and when the egg hatches, then the female comes back with some food for the chick, and then feeds the chick, and then the male can go back to the ocean to feed for himself and get some new food, and then they come back again and they switch back and forth all the time. Until they're a little bit bigger, and like this. Look at this, aren't they cute? They're so nice, so together. But yeah, then both parents go out at sea so they can get twice as much food. And now the chicks are big enough so they don't need protection from their parents anymore. And then when they're big enough, like I think 1 month after this picture, they would be roughly the same size as the adults. And then the adults go to the ocean and the chicks follow them. Well, they're not chicks then anymore. They're young emperor penguins. And they go out and feed for themselves. Now, no polar bears in Antarctica. So they don't have to be afraid. There are not any land predators actually on Antarctica. So they don't have to be afraid for that. They do have to be afraid for things that come from the water. Orcas, for instance. But also this leopard seal. Leopard seals, they do like penguins, and especially young penguins, because they can't swim so well. And they jump into the water and they have to figure out. Papa and mama never told them how to swim, really. They sort of know, but they have to figure that out themselves. And then this leopard seal comes and just grabs them. That's good food for them, of course. This is another seal. Looks really bad with the big teeth and stuff. But yeah, this is a Weddell seal, eating fish and krill, so penguins are actually quite safe for this guy. Here a lone emperor penguin on the ice. So here we have to search as well for our things to find. And here a picture from the air with big icebergs and then the mountains. So this was life on Antarctica. We go back to life in the Arctic. But of course here as well, hey, it's cold and so on. But if you look, then we do find other life as well. We do have, we have penguins. No, we don't have penguins. Penguins are a southern hemisphere species, like I said, but we have something that looks very similar to penguins. These are guillemots or murres. And they evolved a little bit into the same direction as penguins did. Because apparently, if you want to catch food in the water, like penguins do, like these guys do, then you want to look black and white and a nice torpedo shape, so you're camouflaged and you can dive in the water. And yeah, they're very good swimmers. And here we do have polar bears, where I said that penguins don't have to worry about polar bears and stuff because there are no polar bears where penguins are. The animals here, they do have to find to worry about that. Polar bears are very good swimmers. They can swim for days if they have to, but they much rather not. They much rather spend their time on the ice. Walking from over the floes, jumping from one floe to another, and catching seals, because that's what they eat. Yeah, I'm sorry, this is a bit... but yeah, this is how polar bears eat. A lot of blood. They're not nice knife and fork, but yeah, they just especially eat the blubber from the skin, the fat from the seals. But yeah, like I said, of course, I mean, seals are the main dish for polar bears, but they do like other things as well. They wouldn't mind grabbing an guillemot or a murre every now and then. Just a small snack, but hey, we eat snacks as well. So what do the guillemots do? They breed on cliffs. The gentoo penguin could just walk on land and start breeding straight away. If these murres would do that, the polar bear would come and would eat them. So that's not a good option. So they actually fly. So the murres, they can still fly. The guillemots, they can still fly because they have to fly to these cliffs where they can breed safely. Well, at least that's what they think. Because then that's what I saw one time. This was a polar bear climbing down the cliffs, the same cliff as you just saw, just a little bit further along, and grabbing a few of the chicks. The parents still trying to defend, but of course the polar bear wasn't too worried about that. And then he left. But of course, yeah, a guillemot is much smaller than a seal. So there is not that much, was not that much food for him to get. So you also see with the seals, Arctic seals, they're always at the edge of the ice floe. And they're always looking around because if there is a polar bear coming, then they jump into the water because in the water they're safe. There is no leopard seal. In the Arctic. So when they're in the water, they should be relatively safe. And polar bears, they will come from land usually. Other seals, they have a different way of protecting themselves. Yeah, walrus is also a seal, a very big seal, very thick skin. And the skin is so thick that polar bears, even with their big claws, can't get through. So, yeah, they can't really... It's very difficult for a polar bear to kill a walrus. And then they have these big tusks. So, yeah, they might not be able to kill a polar bear with a tusk, but they might be able to injure a polar bear with a tusk. And if a polar bear is injured, it can't hunt anymore, and then it will still die. So, yeah, polar bears know this. So polar bears, they don't really like to hunt for walrus. Of course, they would love to have it because it's a very, very big seal. So if they manage to kill one, they have food for a long time. But yeah, it's very difficult and very risky to do that, so they try not to. Good. I see we're already well past 30 minutes that I was going to talk, so it's time to round it up. A nice, almost a sunset picture from the Arctic, from Spitsbergen. And the Arctic, if we summarize, it's an ocean surrounded by land, and at that border between ocean and land, that's where most of the life is. And it's cold, but it's not that cold, especially not if you compare it to Antarctica. There is more terrestrial life. We had plant life, but we also had birds, we had geese. There are lots of life that actually I didn't show. So yeah, there are lots of other things, other life on land, the Arctic fox that we see. And then at sea, we had polar bears and we had seals. If you compare that to Antarctica, Antarctica was a continent surrounded by ocean. So that's the reverse, the opposite. And also there, life is at the edge between the two. And that's also where we spend most of our time. Antarctica was very cold. When I'm there, by the way, I didn't explain, but in summer at the edge where we are, it's usually a little bit warmer. It's around freezing usually. So that's still doable, I would say. There are hardly any plants. There are only two species of plants and it's almost completely covered in ice. I think it's only 1% of Antarctica not covered in ice. There was no terrestrial life. Well, some insects maybe, some tiny, tiny, minute insects living in between those very few plants, but hardly anything. And if you look at the ocean, we had penguins and seals. The seals are the same, but there are lots of differences actually between the two. Yeah, then to finish off, before I give you the answers to the quiz, we do one last movie. Let's see. Well, it says the Arctic already, so you can figure out what it was, but just to show you a little bit how beautiful these places are. A walrus, or several walrus, hauling out on an ice floe. They're so well insulated, they have such a thick skin, that even if they lay down on the ice doesn't melt and they don't get cold. Some birds flying, kittiwakes. And of course, yeah, if it's this beautiful, then the passengers, they put on a thick jacket and they go outside and enjoy. Yeah, the scenery, but maybe we find something else as well. Oh, you see the tracks? Something has been walking there. I think that's a polar bear. Must be a polar bear there. Wasn't me, at least. Oh, look. There's the polar bear, walking along the shore. Sliding down. And again, we move forward, see what else we can find. You see that white? That's all ice. Oh, look at that. Oh, that's a mother and two cubs. They're about half a year old by now. They spent half of their life in their snow den, and now they're coming out and checking out what we are. Look how cute they are. And they were very curious. They're really looking at the ship all the time. What is that? What do we see? Maybe if I were a little bit taller, then oh look, I can stand on my hind legs. Then I'm taller. Look at that. Yeah, and I smell something. I don't know what smell. It's interesting. But yeah, of course, at some point we have to continue again. All right, time to give you the answers to the quiz. Did you manage to get all the answers yourself? Because I think I've told them all by now. Where do more people live? Well, in the Arctic, we had native people living there, growing up there, being born there, and so on and so on. In Antarctica, there were only scientists. So this is clearly a win for the Arctic. Where do we find more plant life? Where is this picture taken? Well, there were only two species of plants in Antarctica. And there were, I think on Spitsbergen alone, there are already 180 species of plants. And then the rest of the Arctic has even more. So this is clearly, again, a win for the Arctic. Why do polar bears never eat penguins? Now we had a whole range of answers. And actually, most of them are probably true. Penguins are too fast for polar bears. I think if a penguin is in the water, yeah, the penguin will outswim a polar bear. On land, the polar bear might win, most likely. Penguins don't taste good. Not too certain. I've never tasted penguins, so I can't say, but I've heard fairly good stories from other people who have eaten penguins, so I'm not too certain. And answer D, penguin smell, that is definitely true. I've smelled that myself. But yeah, the big thing is, penguins live on the southern hemisphere, polar bears live in the Arctic. So there's just no way that they can get to them. So they never meet. And yeah, if you don't see each other, you can't eat each other, of course. Do we only find penguins on Antarctica? No. Like I said, there are penguins in the Galapagos, Africa, South America, and so on. So it's definitely not only Antarctica. So this was my talk, 45 minutes even. It's longer in English as it is in Dutch. So I hope you liked it. If you want to see more pictures, have a look on my Facebook page or on my website. And maybe see each other again at some point. Thank you very much.